7 years. They were defeated. They'd already declared the surrender and everything else, and they hid themselves and didn't realize that they were finding them years later, still bunkered down and ready for the enemy, reminding me of the devil, how he's hunkered down and fighting on and really thinking somehow he's going to win this war when we know it's over. We've been doing a series on making a difference, and we're going to make a difference in our warfare.
Amen.
We've made a difference in our worship. We preached about prayer and praise and being priests in our home, and we talked about making a difference in our world and how that we locally and long distance we need to be reaching the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we even did something on liberty during that time, speaking about our nation and what a wonderful country we have, and so much to be blessed for being part of this wonderful country. And I love that. And this next couple of weeks, 3 weeks, we're going to be talking about making a difference in the warfare that we're in. And it is a war that we're in. And I'm going to read some scriptures to you. But the Bible says this week, and taking this text as our major theme text for this making a difference here in Jude, where it says that of some have compassion, making a difference, verse 22. And that's what we've been dealing with in reaching the world and in our worship and showing forth the love of God and compassion towards God and towards others. But today, we're going to step into the nitty-gritty. We're going to stop into that in verse 23, which says, and others saved with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment that was spotted. And that comes when first is compassion, but now he's saying, but we're in a real battle. We're in a real fight. The devil's really wants to destroy us. And so there's some people, many people, the only way you're going to get them, you're going to have to reach in there right through the flames of hell and grab them out. You're going to have to stare the devil right in the eye and say, they're not yours, Satan, and pull them out and say, David belongs to you. Hallelujah. Eric belongs to you. Better to stand up than to sit down. I couldn't get David to get up, but I'll tell you. If I thought he was going to the flames of hell, you better believe I put both hands. He'd be standing up whether he wanted to or not. That's what he talks about, pulling them up, doing whatever we got to do. Hallelujah, in this world that we live in. I'm telling you, we have a real enemy out there, a real warfare. We're going to talk today about our enemy. Next week, Rob is going to talk about the equipment that God has given to us to fight that enemy. And then next week, I think David is going to be preaching on the empowerment that God has given to us to overcome this enemy for the glory of God. So we're excited about that. And trust that God's going to bless us here. But I want you to turn right now to Ephesians chapter 6 as I take a text here. And I want to talk about how knowing your enemy. Knowing your enemy. We're going to dissect these verses over the next few weeks and trust it will touch your hearts. But it says this, verse 10 of chapter 6 of Ephesians. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, above all, taking the shield of faith, wherein ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication of all saints. Hallelujah. And then he goes on to say, and for me, that utterance may be given unto me, and we want you to pray that right now for me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. Hallelujah. How many pray for your pastor? How many know that we go through battles sometimes and you don't go through? We go through. We're intimidated sometimes and we struggle and we battle. And all I need to do is ask you to speak a few times and you understand just a small little bit of what we go through week after week, year after year, month after month, thousands and thousands and thousands of times, opening the scripture. the Word of God, preparing it, all that goes into it, and the war that goes on, I'm telling you, physically, mentally, emotionally, I'm telling you, the devil, every time I open the Word of God, the devil throws everything he can at me to try and hinder what God wants to be said in a service. That is the war that we are in as pastors, trying to get across the Word of God. This is a real battle that we're in, and we recognize, and I thank God we can stare the devil in the face and say, get deep behind me, Satan, but I need your help. I need your prayers. I need you to be crying out to God, because I'm telling you, you don't want to fight this battle alone. You need everyone on your side, and I need you on my side. Amen. So pray for your pastor, amen. That's what Paul said, pray for me. Pray for that, I'll be bold. I'm in prison, I'm going through it, and I just need to be bold for the Lord. I want to speak God's word with boldness and strength and power. I want to touch lives. I want to see God do something in hearts and lives. And I'm telling you, it will happen if we pray together and believe together. I'm telling you, you're just as much a part of this sermon as I am. If you bring me before the Lord and say, God, so anoint our pastor. Protect our pastor. Keep our pastor, Lord, from every temptation, every power, every work of the darkness that would come against him. Keep our pastor. Keep his mind pure. Keep his mind stayed on you. Keep his mind filled with peace and filled with the power of God. Keep his mind, oh Lord, in his affections on you. You'll pray that for me. I need that prayer. I need that prayer every day. God will give me wisdom and enlightenment and understanding of his word. This is spiritual. This is not some preparation that we just do. Every time I open the word of God, this is a treasure. And out of that treasure, only God can give us the truths that we need to implant in our hearts. And so Paul cried out, we're in a war. And at the end of this, he said, please, for God's sake, pray for me. It's not easy, but you pray for me, and God will make it easy. Hallelujah. Amen?
Yes.
Hallelujah. I just had to put that in there. I was going to stop with verse 18. Usually I do, but I was touched by that verse to tears. As I felt what Paul was feeling in. And only when you have to be in that place do you understand the pressures and the problems you face. And Paul desired the prayers of the saints. And any man of God, he is an absolute idiot if he doesn't desire the cries of the saints of God. So if you would pray for me, I deeply would appreciate it. Amen. It says, put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Paul names our enemy in verse 11. His name is
the devil.
The devil. I know he's got many names. We're going to talk about some of those names. We need to know our enemy. That is the problem with the war against ISIS. Our president to this day, as far as I know, has not been able to say that they are the radical Islamic movement out there of terrorists. He's afraid to use those words. He will not name our enemy. He will not recognize what's going on in this world. And because of that, America is caught in the middle. Our soldiers want to do one thing, but the White House is wanting to do another thing. We're wanting to go into war against our enemy, and they're wanting to negotiate with liars.
Yes.
Negotiate with those who desire to destroy us and sift us like wheat. They want to come into some agreement with Satan. How can you sit at the same table with the devil and the law? You cannot do what the Bible says. You're just mixing yourself up in a mess, and that's the way our government is run, but that's not the way God wants to run his church. We got an enemy, and he wants us to name our enemy and be bold against our enemy and let him know we are not going to bow to him. We're not going to negotiate with him. We're going to command him and have authority over him, and he will and must listen to us. Not to anyone else. He will listen to God's people. We can resist the devil once, and he will flee from us. And I believe that's the way you have to deal with the enemy. Amen?
Amen.
We need to get to to know who our enemy is. We've got so many names. You already said Satan. We call him the devil. The devil, he's a false accuser. He's a slanderer. But also speaks of him as Beelzebub, the Lord of the flies. He's called Satan, the tempter, the wicked one, the accuser of the brother, the ruler of this world, the god of this age, the prince and power of the air. 2 Corinthians, he's called the one that transforms himself into an angel of light. I'm telling you, he's like a roaring lion. He's like that one that snatches the seed of God's word out of the hearts of man. He is a wolf in sheep's clothing. I'm telling you, all kinds of descriptions for him. And he's called the old serpent, the dragon. I'm telling you, he's got a lot of names. Give to us the nature of this wicked, evil liar. For he is the father of lies. Not just a liar. He is the father of all lies, the Bible says. And that's the one I'm talking about today. He's real. He's very powerful. But oh, he is nothing compared to God Almighty.
Amen.
You know, the sad part is nearly 2 out of 3 American adults, 62%, agree that Satan is not a living being, but a symbol of evil. Did you know that? Yeah, that's right. And even more alarming is that among the evangelical Christians, listen to this, according to Barna, 52% deny Satan's existence. Yeah, it's almost like Hillary and Obama. Help! They're coming to kill us! Help! Help!
Did you hear something?
Help! 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 They're coming! I hope the broadcast is crossed. The towers of White House. Let our ambassador, our wonderful military men, be slaughtered and carried in disgrace for hours. Because they didn't want to recognize that they were being attacked. They didn't want to recognize that there was a real enemy out there wanting to destroy. I'm telling you, that's why we're so defeated in America, and we're defeated in the church, because we got over half the church, evangelical Christians, doubting, wondering if there really is a personal devil. How can you win a battle against the enemy when you don't even believe there is one?
Amen.
So ignorant. Mm-hmm. You cannot even see the devices of the devil in all of his tactics and what's going on. I'm telling you. It's like people that are like ostriches that stick their head in the ground and think that everything just stops once they stick their head in the ground. They're safe. It's so funny. It's like an ostrich sitting there with his head in the ground, reminding me of a snake. We just went to a cemetery one time, and there was a snake, and his head was down there, but the rest of his body was out. And he's sitting inside this hole, and I'm looking at him and I said, "You poor snake, you're going to die in about 2 seconds. And you don't even know it." He thought he was hiding, and he had 3/4 of his body step out of the hole. So stupid. That's the devil. That's the way our government is run. That's the way so many people in the church live their lives. They are totally ignorant of what's going on.
Ouch.
I'm telling you, sad. 72% of Catholics say the devil is non-existent. One of the major battlefields is taking place right now in the church. And if we can just get this one doctrine straight, we can just get this one concept in our mind here at Bethel, there is an enemy, and his name is the devil. It's Satan. He's real, real, real. Not just some power out there, some force. He is a real person, and he is out to destroy you. And you need to know. Amen? And we make a mockery of it today in our magazines, our movies, our music. It's all emphasis on the dreadful dead and the evil and the wickedness. We have the voodoo and the zombies and the vampires and all these filthy movies that come on, and you see it everywhere. It's like, what in the world? They're corrupting our minds and our youth and everything else, allowing them to watch all this crazy, foolish, evil stuff, and then they get hooked on it. Reminds of a kid back in 1972, they introduced him in school to the occult. Introduced him in school, started teaching on the occult in their class, and he stood up after class and says, "One thing I'll never do, I'll never get mixed up in the occult." 6 weeks later, shot and he killed his mother and his father. And turned around and shot himself and killed himself under the influence of demonic powers that came to him in a classroom in their school. That's what's going on all the time in America.
That's right.
Breeded by the television, breeded by our schools, breeded constantly by the media and the newspapers and magazines. Everything that's going on is breeded in our minds. So our poor kids, I'm telling you, let's say parents will guard them and protect them, and they're being invaded every moment into their mind. And that's where the battle is going right now for your hearts and your wills and the desires that the devil would have for you. I'm here to say, we're at this church ready to battle for your soul, David. We're a battle for your soul, heaven. We want you to make heaven more than anything else in the world, heaven. Hallelujah, heaven.
Yes.
Anybody makes heaven, heaven's going to make heaven. Amen. I'm going to do all I can to get her there. And I know it's a battle. Every time she goes home, whatever she faces in life, in school, wherever it is, it's a battle to live for God. And to say no to the devil and all the powers are out there. But he's real. And once you recognize he's real, begin to battle against him and resist him. I'm telling you, he will run from you.
Amen.
Where did he come from? Well, the Bible says he was from the beginning. Hallelujah. And that he sinned from the beginning. So we know he had a beginning way back there in 1 John 3:8. It talks about that. And we hear a little bit, see a little bit about it in Ezekiel 28, where the Son of Man, the prophet Ezekiel, is speaking and talks to the Son of the Man and says, take up a lamentation upon the king of Tyrus. So the Spirit of God is speaking to Ezekiel to bring forth this message. And it looks like he's talking about a king, the king of Tyrus. But as he goes on to describe this king, we realize it's not really the king of Tyrus. He was a very, very evil man. But the description that God gives to us goes far beyond the king of Tyrus. And say unto him, thus saith of the Lord. This is Ezekiel 28, verse 12. Thou sealest up the sun, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was thy covering. The sardis, the topaz, and the diamond, the pearl, and the onyx, and the jasper, and the sapphire, and the emerald, and the carbuncle, and the gold, the workmanship of thy tabrets, and thy pipes, was prepared in thee in the day that thou wast created. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth, and I have set thee so. Thou wast upon the holy mountain of God. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. Thou wast perfect in thy ways from the day that thou wast created till iniquity was found in thee. It gives us an insight into this anointed cherub, this one that guarded the throne, this one that had the pipes, the organs of worshiping, was the ark worshiper of all the archangels. He ran the worship that went on around the throne of God and protected it with praise. Hallelujah. And we somehow sin entered into the heart of the devil. That is a mystery that we don't understand fully. We do know what that sin was, though, because over in Isaiah chapter 14, it talks about what happened. He was perfect in all his ways. We know that he was the created one, but something corrupted him. Corrupted till iniquity was found in thee. What was that? That's the mystery of theology. We don't understand how this all took place, other than we believe that Satan had a will. And somehow, God gave him that will, and he made a decision. And he chose to rise up against God. And in Isaiah 14, it says that five times he said, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. It reveals to us, as he's speaking again, of a character that doesn't fit the description of the king of Babylon at that time. It was a character that definitely was some kind of spiritual being. And through the study of other scriptures tied in with all of this, we see this was the downfall of Satan. And the sin that was in his heart is the sin that will damn every one of us, and it is the sin of pride.
Amen.
And that pride rose within him, and Satan became corrupt and was cast out of heaven. And the Bible speaks of it in Luke 18, 12, 9 of a revelation, and Jude 1, 6, and so many other scriptures I can read to you. He was cast out, and a third of the angels were cast out with him, and they're sent into hell. It was prepared not for man, but for Satan. And that's where he resides. But he's on a long chain, and he can reach around the world. And he roams about seeking whom he may devour, along with all of his demons, these fallen angels, and all of these imps, and all of these wicked powers. They're roaming, billions of them, around the world. I'm telling you, and it creates these principalities and these powers, and this evil darkness that has invaded the world and is saturating America, even as I speak to you today.
Amen.
Not only is he a corrupted being, but he is a condemned being. And we know that at the end of the day, hallelujah, he's going to be cast into the lake of fire, according to Revelation chapter 20, verse 10. But I'm going to talk about that at the beginning. All I want you to know is he is real. And his origin was in the times past, back in eternity somewhere, where he rebelled, was cast down, and we are in this mess that we're in today, because when he came to the garden and tempted Eve, she said yes to the devil and no to God. And ever since then, we've all inherited this nature that wants to say yes to the devil and no to God.
Amen.
And there's only one way to get victory over that. And it's through the blood of Jesus Christ and the testimony of our faith in him. Hallelujah. I'm telling you. But I'm not going to deal with that. Brother Robbie's going to help you down the road. I just want you to see that he was created. Oh, but he was corrupted. And he was condemned. Amen. And he opposes us. He is our opposition. Amen. He's the enemy, our foe, our opponent. He never intends good for you, Cody. Never. His intent is never good. It's always evil. Even when it looks good, it's never for good. That's why Paul tells us in 6:11, put on the whole armor of God that you be able to stand against the wiles, the strategies, the tricks, the deceptive ways of the devil. It says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. This is no game. This is an all-out war for your soul and for my soul. We can never let up in this battle that we're waging against Satan. And he will stop at nothing to get you. And if you think you can fight him when you're wrong, you are a fool. If you think you can just weasel through this Christian life and not do the things that will build up a bulwark and help you to overcome the enemy, he will overcome you. He will destroy you. He'll wipe you out like he did the sons of Sceva. Don't joke with the devil. He's real, he's powerful, and he will wipe you out. About the time you think you've got him, about the time you think you can handle him, that's when he'll cripple you and destroy you. Mark my word, I've been down that road. I've seen it happen over and over again. It's almost happened to me 1,000 times. The enemy's come against me in my early Christian life and on. Even now, I'm telling you, if you've seen the battle I went through since early this morning, it's like the devil was so real. I had to battle, stop and claim the blood of Jesus Christ and rebuke the devil and stand against him. I thought, God, how can this be while I'm working on this sermon? I got so mad at the devil alone. I would have made a more ruckus, but my wife was sleeping. Surprised she didn't hear me. It got bad. He's not easy to spot either, I'm telling you. Sometimes it's very obvious. It says it's to detect him. It's not so easy sometimes. The Bible says he's like an angel of light. And, I'm telling you, I hate being in a war where you can't detect the enemy. It's Vietnam. Could have been a little child. Could have been an old lady. Or a lonely young man. You just never knew. Who was going to blow you up? Who was going to kill you? That was horrible war. Because you didn't know who the enemy was. You couldn't believe that a little child would blow you up with a grenade. These guys went through it. You've seen it. You had experiences. I can't even believe the nightmare of going through that battle and seeing the horrendous things that took place in Vietnam. One of the most horrible wars we ever fought. It's because we were not allowed to get the enemy. They played around horses around in Washington and allowed our men to die left and right and came back barred and demented in their minds and dying with all of these Never watch a movie where you can't figure out who the villain is?
Yes.
I hate those kind of movies. You wait. I pick it up, and I listen. Now I've learned how to do it. The one that I don't think it is, that's why I say I think it's him. It's hard. Sometimes, no, especially when they get this all done. The ambulance works like this. Now he's got what we call the IEDs out there. And he's got them planted. And I want you to know this. These are the improvised explosive devices that have been blowing up our soldiers. And I didn't know this until I was researching for this. But 63% of the coalition's deaths in Iraq in the Second War there was caused by IEDs. In the battle in Afghanistan, 66% of our coalition's deaths were caused by IEDs, unseen, undetected, buried just under the soil, or in a stuff where they can take a phone and electronically kick it off at the right time, at the right moment. They got to take a phone or what? We don't even know it's coming. Where are? Got you. That's the way the devil works.
Yeah.
Roaming, watching, seeking, where every moment. Playing on your mind, tempting you, trying to get you to a place where he can destroy you. I'm telling you, it's a horrible thing to have an enemy that you do not know, and he's hard to detect. Only the spiritual can detect the wiles of the devil. Only the spiritual that pray and seek and wait on God and learn his word can detect the IEDs of the devil. But I'm telling you, it's real, and you better be aware of it, or it will destroy you. Yeah. Mark my word, I've seen it happen to so many hundreds of young people, especially, and older ones. I've seen even pastors in their 60s. I had a pastor friend who was almost 65 and fell in love with a 44-year-old young evangelist lady. She was a missionary, and he was a missionary to Haiti, and so was she. And so he left his 75-year-old wife and ran off with that woman and married her. And forfeited his ministry and everything for this affair. And 6 months later, he died of a heart attack. Wow. The devil had an IED, man. The IED, boy. He blew him up, and he was a fool to fall for it.
Yes.
It's always a reminder, you never get too old for the devil.
Amen.
He never gives up on you. He can even get you with depression and suicide and all kinds of things in your old age where you just feel like, I'm not worth anything. I have no reason for living. Oh, yes, you do. You got a voice of mind, a heart to pray and seek God. I'm telling you, God's got a plan. God's got a purpose in your life. And don't you let the devil ever lie to you.
That's right.
I don't care what you get. You got a purpose. You're still alive. You've got a purpose on this earth. Use it for the glory of God. Yeah, you might not be able to get up the way you did before. But hey, let's lay in that chair and say, Jesus, 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 Jesus. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Cover, Pastor. Come. If that's all you do all day long, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Cover, Pastor. Cover, protect and keep him. Oh, Jesus, if that's all you do the rest of your life, hallelujah. Pastor, I'm serious. I'm dead serious. The power of that prayer. The power of that heart. Surrender to God, I'm telling you, it's a force that the enemy cannot handle.
Amen.
I'm telling you, it's hard to detect these, the devil. I'm telling you, remember that guy that drove the ice cream truck in France? It was a great big truck, he was delivering ice cream, he said.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, in France, they drove through all those people, killed them, ate some people. It was an ice cream truck, he was on his way to deliver ice cream. So he said. Oh, the devil will come and pray. I got ice cream for you. Then the problem is it's filled with arsenic. You just never know. And so you have to be so aware. Be sober. Be vigilant. Your adversary, the devil, is roaming up seeking whom he may devour. He is our opposition. He opposes us. I'm telling you. Counterfeits the things of God. Satan has his own trinity. The devil, the beast, the false prophet, the Father, Son, the Holy Ghost. He has his own church. It's called the synagogues of Satan in Revelation 2:19. He has his own ministers. They're called the ministers.
sacrifice. The Bible says two demons. He has his own communion service. The Bible speaks of the cup of demons. He has his own ministers to proclaim his own gospel, a gospel that is contrary to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And he has his own throne and his own worshipers. You read about it in Revelation. And he still hasn't got it that he's defeated, but I'm telling you, he's real. And he's putting everything he's got into it. He's an imitator of God, and he inspires false Christ. He self-constitutes the messiahs of this world and tries to raise them up as false prophets and false antichrists and priests and teachers. And they're out there everywhere. Specialists in theology, in our massive Harvards and Princetons and everywhere else that know the Bible and teach it in heresy and false doctrine every day. That's the mountains and powers in high places. They're out there. And the devil is behind all of that. And he also introduces false brethren into the church who can sneak in. They spy out our liberty, the Bible says, in order to bring us into bondage. I'm telling you, they're out there. And they're being sponsored by the devil. He's got strategies. All kinds of strategies. Many of us are being ignorant of the devices, the wiles of the devil. He loves to blind the mind of the unregenerated. That's his strategy against the sinners, the ones that don't know him. He keeps their eyes blinded. That's why we need to go and open their eyes with the Word of God. Amen? I don't have time to deal with all these things, but he loves to snatch the good seed out of the hearts of men, Jesus said. He's out there. The moment we tell somebody about Jesus, the devil's right there to take it out and bring doubts or fears into their mind to keep them from making a decision to follow the Lord Jesus Christ. That is one of the tactics, strategies of the devil. He loves to lay snares for them. Paul challenged Timothy in 2 Timothy 25 and 26. He said this, in meekness, instructing those that are oppose himself in God's peradventure will give them repentance to the non-indulging of the truth, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil. The lust of the flesh, the pride of life, the lust of this life. I'm telling you, it's out there, and the devil's out to get us. Pride of life, masquerading as an angel of light, doing all that he can to get us. Hallelujah. And then he works within the church. In every way he can. He likes to annihilate and to neutralize the church and its witness from within by creating sin within the camp, like Ananias and Sapphira, and trying to bring a damper to the revival that God wants to bring. And only one sin, like Achan in the camp, can bring havoc into that which God wants to do. A powerful persecution was brought against the church to try and stop the Word of God from flourishing. And he likes to smother the witness by great popularity, like it was in the days of Constantine, when Christianity became popular by force. And if you didn't become a Christian, you were locked up. And so they did like the Muslims were doing. They were there for several years, forcing people to become Christians. And it corrupted the church. The devil had a heyday. And we're doing it today. We have all these false prophets, so many of them, giving us a grace that's cheap and free, a grace that says if you live anywhere you want to live and still go to heaven, still be forgiven. And there's no need of repentance, no need to give it a sin, just do anything you want to do, and it's all right with our gracious and loving God. That is a heresy that contradicts the Word of God, and it's out there everywhere. One great preacher just a couple weeks ago messed up his life. He was propagating, it's okay to drink, there's nothing wrong with drinking, he just lost his job. 30,000 people in this church. I've listened to him many times, but he used to aggravate me so much, he said, it's okay to drink, just do it in moderation, just do it in moderation. The problem happened though, he started doing it without moderation. And it got a grip of him, it got a hold of him like a serpent, and it destroyed his ministry. 30,000 people. Hey, it's real. We reiterate it all the time.
Amen.
But just because it's big and powerful and beautiful, just because it can flow with words like Hitler and move nations, doesn't mean it's of God. Beware. Line it with the Word of God. Everything with the Word of God. Everything with the Word of God. I want to close on a positive note. Everyone said?
Amen.
Amen. I'm not about to leave out that door without putting the devil in his place.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, because I've opened up a can of worms, and he's going to come at you like he's never come at you before. Because you're going to walk around your barn. Hallelujah. I want you to beware. So I'm going to give you some scriptures. And this last one is, he is overcome.
Yes. Amen.
Can you say that?
He is overcome.
Yeah, I love this. He sounds so powerful, so prestigious, so pompous, and he loves to intimidate us. But Paul lets us know we can stand against Satan and overcome him. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand, stand therefore. Robbie's going to be dealing with that next week, but I just want to touch on a couple of things real quick before I let you leave. I just want to end this by saying we do not need to fear our enemy. He is defeated. He is a defeated foe, and we can and shall overcome him. Read Revelation chapter 2, chapter 3. Every one of those churches overcame. Everyone overcame. There was always a nucleus of those that said, Satan's not going to get me. I'm going to overcome by the grace of God. Hallelujah. He that committed sin is the devil. For the devil sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. 1 John 3:8. Ye are of God, little children, the Bible says, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. If God be for us, what? Who can be against us? Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee. You submit yourselves, hallelujah. Resist, I'm telling you, he has no authority over you. We have the same authority as Jesus, who said, get thee behind me, Satan. We do not need to give the devil a speck of our soul. Neither give place to the devil, the Bible says. You don't have to. He's given you authority to say, no.
Yes.
No. I'm not going to sell my soul, I'm not going to sell my body, I'm not going to sell my mind, my spirit to you, Satan. I belong to Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
I've been bought with a price. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
The God of peace shall bruise Satan under your feet, Paul said. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all, amen. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of the testimony. And they loved not the lives unto death. Yes. We got a big enemy. But we have a bigger God. Yes, we are in a major war, but we are the winners.
Amen.
If we faint not and fight on. Paul said, wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in that evil day. And having done all to stand, stand therefore. We can make a difference in this war. We can stand for righteousness in an ungodly world. We can stand against the conventional wisdom with the wisdom of God. We can stand against the wiles of the devil with the word of divine truth. We can stand against our corrupt culture with the authority of the commands of God. We can stand against the perverted lifestyles of our day with our pure, unadulterated lives being a light in this dark and sinful world. Remember, though we are in wrestling match with the devil and Satan and his principalities and his powers and his rulers and the darkness and the spiritual wickedness in high places, I want you to remember this. The principles of God are always more powerful than the principles and the principalities of Satan.
Amen.
Lord, give you this.
Amen.
The power of God is always greater than the power of evil.
Amen.
The authority of the light of God's word is always greater than the rulers of darkness of this world.
Amen.
And the Son of Righteousness who reigns on high always will always be greater than the spiritual wickedness in high places.
Amen.
All we have to do is stand.
Yes,
and with everything that lies within us, we stand against the enemy and saying, I'm going to live for Jesus Christ. He is the captain of my salvation, and he is leading this war, and I'm right behind him, and because of him, I am more than a conqueror through Christ who loved me.
Took it out. Oh, it was there. I had to cut it off, though.
because I was taking these six beautiful girls to school every morning, mini skirts and all. And I thought, oh, this is not bad. So you know what I did? I told the girls that I brought them blankets and gave them blankets to put over their knees so I wouldn't have to look at their nakedness. And the next day when I went to pick them up, there, none of them got it naked. I'm here today because of that. Thank God I was a simple believer. I wasn't letting some girl destroy my soul. And God brought a wonderful wife in my life. Love the Lord, she played the organ, sang, love God. And I said, Lord, if there's any way, if there's any way I can have her, if you see fit to give this rotten wretch the things I did in my life, if you could just, Lord, have me a wonderful wife. And I prayed this, God knew she was going to be my wife. I just didn't know if she knew that. So I said, Lord, open her eyes. Let her see how wonderful I am. And I don't know how he manipulated that in heaven. I do not know. But she fell in love with me. I fell in love with her. And what a courtship it's been all these years. 47 years now since we started going together. 43 married, 4 years. Girlfriend, boyfriend, that got real testy a few times. This came one time I said, we can't even hold hands. I just hold her hand, just shot shockwaves through me. Yep, in there. But here I am today. This has been a battle, it's been a battle. I fought the devil, I fought him all the way. And I'll probably fight him the rest of the way until it's over. But I am determined to stand. I've come too far to sit down. And so stand with me. Even if you don't want to stand, you stand with me. We're going to sing this wonderful song. Let this be your determination as you leave these doors today. And if you're struggling, you're going through a battle in your life, these altars are open. I would love for you to come and pray. I will come and pray with you. And I want to see you stand strong for the Lord and in the power of His might. I want God to do that work in your life that He wants to do. I don't know what you're going through, young and old, it doesn't matter to me. All I know is we are in an attack. If you feel the pressure of the devil, come and give that pressure to Jesus. Leave these doors in victory and let God have His way in your life. God bless you. Up and pray again. Come to the altars and pray. You can feel dismissed after we sing this song. Yeah. cover us with your word. Cover us with your spirit. Surround us, hedge us in your presence. Go before us, Lord. Come behind us. Walk beside us. Lord, let us be in the center of it all. And God, use us to be a light in this dark world. And to resist the devil, no matter where it's at, in the name of Jesus. And to be overcomers, victorious in Christ, in every situation. God, may we bring many to Christ through the life that we live. I'll praise you for us. So bless them. Smile upon us. Keep us in the center of